Now let us move on to the next important topic in cardiovascular system, that is heart failure. Heart failure is the inability of the heart to maintain adequate cardiac output that is required to meet the metabolic demands of the body. Inability of the heart to maintain adequate cardiac output that is needed to maintain the metabolic demands of the body. It is mainly characterized by important manifestations or clinical features like tachycardia, breathlessness, fatigue, peripheral edema, pulmonary edema, and cardiomegaly. These are the important characteristic signs and symptoms of heart failure. The heart failure can be systolic failure. It can be systolic failure. That means the failure of contractility, pumping failure. It can be because of some cardiomyopathies, or it can be a diastolic failure. It can be diastolic failure. So the reason for the systolic failure can be cardiomyopathy. Diastolic failure means it is unable to relax during the diastole properly. So when it is unable to relax, it cannot fill with blood effectively during diastole. So the reason can be stiffening, hypertrophy, ischemia, all these resulting in inadequate relaxation. That is what is diastolic failure. Then we have low output failure. Low output means the heart may have systolic failure or diastolic failure, because of which it is unable to maintain adequate cardiac output. The metabolic demands of the body are not high, they are normal only, but even that normal metabolic needs of the body are unable to be met because of low output failure. So low output failure, the reason can be either systolic failure or diastolic failure. And we have another term known as high output failure. High output means the demands of the body are high. The metabolic demands of the body are high. So otherwise the cardiac output is normal, but because the body demands, metabolic demands have become so high that even increased cardiac output is unable to meet them. So that is what is known as high output failure. So the example for high output failure can be thyrotoxicosis, severe anemia, pregnancy, AV shunting, etc. That is what is the difference between low output and high output. Then we have left-sided failure. Left-sided failure means, for example, left ventricular is failing. When the left ventricular fails, it cannot receive the blood from left atrium. Left atrium in turn cannot receive the blood from lungs. So there will be stagnation of blood in the lungs, and that will lead to pulmonary edema. Right heart failure means the blood will be not proper, blood is not properly received into the right part of the heart. So the blood will remain in the periphery, that will lead to peripheral edema. The left heart failure and right heart failure are only the initiating events. Over a period of time, left heart failure will extend to right heart, and right heart failure will extend to left heart and becomes the failure of the whole heart. Next, to understand the mechanism of action of drugs that are used in the treatment of heart failure, we need to review briefly the physiology of cardiac contraction. Physiology of cardiac muscle contraction. So you know that calcium is required for contraction of any muscle. Okay, so let us imagine this is the cardiac myocyte. We have calcium channel here. So extracellular calcium enters the cardiac myocyte through the calcium channel. This calcium is extracellular calcium. So extracellular calcium enters the cell through the calcium channel that is present on the cell membrane. And this calcium stimulates the calcium that is stored in the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So this extracellular calcium stimulates the release of stored calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum through a ryanodine channel. Ryanodine receptor channel. This is what is known as calcium dependent calcium release. Extracellular calcium dependent intracellular calcium release into cytoplasm. So that is why extracellular calcium is known as trigger calcium. So in case of cardiac muscle and vascular smooth muscle, for their contraction they need extracellular calcium. So extracellular calcium enters through the calcium channel into the cell, which in turn stimulate the release of intracellular stored calcium in the sarcoplasmic reticulum into the cytoplasm through the ryanodine receptor channel. And the calcium is released into the cytoplasm, and intracytoplasmic calcium levels ultimately increase. So this causes activation of contractile apparatus, productive interaction between actin and myosin. So this is contractile apparatus consisting of actin, myosin and other contractile proteins. So ultimately this will lead to contraction. Once the contraction is over, the blood will be pumped into the respective compartments from atria and ventricles. And once the contraction is over, the heart has to relax. This is possible only when the intracytoplasmic calcium levels are brought down to the normal levels. So for the heart muscle, for the cardiac muscle to relax, the intracytoplasmic calcium level should be minimized. So where should the calcium go? The calcium should go back again to the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and that is taken care by sarcoplasmic endoplasmic reticulum calcium ATPase. So this is a pump that sequestrates the intracytoplasmic calcium back to the sarcoplasmic reticulum, number one. Then the calcium should also go out, because some calcium has come from outside, which has stimulated the release of stored calcium from sarcoplasmic reticulum, ultimately increasing intracytoplasmic calcium concentration, and this causes contraction. And once the contraction is done, the calcium should go back to their respective places. So sarcoplasmic endoplasmic reticulum calcium ATPase sequestrates some of the calcium back to the sarcoplasmic reticulum intracellular storage site, and the remaining calcium has to go out. For this, it utilizes a transporter known as sodium calcium exchanger. Sodium calcium exchanger in this context pumps calcium out of the cell in exchange for sodium ions. And this sodium calcium exchanger is dependent on another important pump, ATP energized sodium potassium ATPase, ATP energized sodium potassium pump. So we have sodium potassium. So potassium is transported into the cell and sodium is pumped out. So the sodium calcium exchanger works by the gradient provided by the sodium potassium ATPase. In other words, for the effective functioning of sodium calcium exchanger, sodium potassium ATPase is required. So sodium calcium exchanger works by the or utilizes the gradient provided by the sodium potassium ATPase. So if you inhibit sodium potassium ATPase, sodium calcium exchanger also is inhibited. So there is accumulation of calcium inside, and this triggers the release of stored calcium from sarcoplasmic reticulum and increases contraction. This is what is the exact mechanism of action of digoxin. So digoxin binds with sodium potassium ATPase and inhibits. Digoxin inhibits sodium potassium ATPase. When sodium potassium ATPase is inhibited, indirectly the function of sodium calcium exchanger is also inhibited. So sodium calcium exchanger has to pump out calcium, but that is not happening. So calcium accumulates inside the cell, and this calcium stimulates the release of stored calcium from sarcoplasmic reticulum. So this increases intracytoplasmic calcium levels and increases the force of contraction. That is what is the exact sequence of events that result by administration of digoxin. So digoxin inhibits sodium potassium ATPase. Indirectly, sodium calcium exchanger is also inhibited. Calcium is not extruded. Calcium is accumulated, stimulates stored calcium, increases intracytoplasmic calcium, and increases force of contraction. That is what is the normal physiology of contraction. Then let us see what will happen during heart failure. What kind of compensatory changes that occur during heart failure? So in heart failure, the cardiac output decreases. The cardiac output decreases. So heart failure is characterized by decreased cardiac output. So decreased cardiac output will decreases, this decreases carotid firing. Decreased cardiac output decreases blood pressure, and this decreased blood pressure decreases carotid firing. So this causes compensatory activation of sympathetic discharge. So this leads to compensatory sympathetic nervous system activation. So I repeat again, in heart failure there is decreased cardiac output. Decreased cardiac output will decrease blood pressure, and decreased blood pressure will decrease carotid sinus firing, and this will lead to increased sympathetic activation by a compensatory mechanism. So increased sympathetic activation is nothing but release of norepinephrine. So this norepinephrine release, so norepinephrine acts by increasing blood pressure. It tries to increase blood pressure by activating two types of receptors, alpha 1 and beta 1. So let us see beta 1 actions first. So beta 1 receptors are present in the heart, and stimulation of this beta 1 will lead to increased heart rate and increased force of contraction. So that will increase cardiac output, and the problem is solved, and we call it as cardiac output via compensation, increased cardiac output via compensation. This is what is desirable, this is what is required in a failing heart. But apart from this, unfortunately, unavoidably, simultaneously, some other thing will also happen. What is that? Norepinephrine also acts on alpha 1 receptors. You know, where are these alpha 1 receptors present? They are present in the blood vessels. They are present both in arteries and veins. For example, alpha 1 is stimulated in the vein. That will lead to increased venous return. That increases preload. Increased preload. See, increased preload is nothing but increased burden on the heart. And alpha 1 in the arteries will lead to increased afterload. So the compensatory sympathetic activation causing the release of norepinephrine is serving two purposes. It is producing, or it is having two consequences. On the positive side, it is activating beta 1 receptors and increasing heart rate and force of contraction, increasing cardiac output, and the problem is solved. But simultaneously, it is also activating alpha 1 in the veins, and it is increasing venous return and preload. In the arteries, it is increasing afterload. So increased preload and increased afterload will act opposite. They act opposite to the heart. So that will cause again burden on the heart. But this is simultaneously unavoidably happening because of the release of norepinephrine as a compensatory mechanism. And we have on the other side, when there is decreased cardiac output, I will tell you what is happening simultaneously on the negative side. There is decreased renal blood flow. Renal blood flow is decreased because of decreased cardiac output. When there is decreased cardiac output, there is decreased renal blood flow. So this decreased blood flow, renal blood flow, will stimulate renin. Will stimulate the renin. So you know, renin causes conversion of angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1, angiotensin 1. Then it is subsequently converted to angiotensin 2, and this will stimulate vasoconstriction and increases again preload and afterload, because angiotensin 2 is a potent vasoconstrictor. Then angiotensin 2 stimulates aldosterone. Aldosterone causes sodium and water retention. This increases blood volume. The heart is failing and it is unable to take care of normal volume only, and the blood volume is increased here. Not only that, this aldosterone, angiotensin 2, norepinephrine altogether they cause remodeling, hyperplasia, vascular smooth muscle, increased fibrosis and remodeling in the ventricles especially. So ultimately all the so-called compensatory mechanisms will become self-defeating, and over a period of time the patient will ultimately land up in decompensated heart failure. This is highly dangerous condition. That is why the mortality rate, 5-year mortality rate in congestive heart failure is almost 50%. 5-year mortality rate in heart failure is almost 50% because of this vicious circle. So whenever there is decrease in the cardiac output, there is compensatory activation of sympathetic nervous system. So on the positive side, it increases beta 1 mediated heart rate and force of contraction to increase cardiac output. That is what is known as compensated heart failure. So heart failure is compensated. But on the other hand, simultaneously there is alpha 1 mediated increase in preload and afterload, as well as angiotensin 2 mediated preload and afterload. So that will lead to burden on the heart. So also there is retention of sodium and water, which increases blood volume, and all these mechanisms they are like a vicious circle, and ultimately the so-called compensatory mechanisms become self-defeating and the patient will ultimately land up into decompensated heart failure. So these are the important pathophysiological points to be noted with regard to progression of the disease. So increased sympathetic activity, activation of renin angiotensin aldosterone system, and ventricular remodeling. These are all the important ones. So finally, the three culprits, the three bad substances here responsible for this pathophysiology or pathological progression of the disease are norepinephrine, angiotensin 2, and aldosterone. So with this background, let us now move on to the treatment of heart failure, drugs used in the treatment of heart failure. Now let us start the drugs used in heart failure. The first group of drugs are cardiac glycosides. So we have digoxin, digitoxin and aubaine. Digoxin, digitoxin, aubaine. So these are the three important cardiac glycosides. They are obtained from a plant known as Digitalis lanata. They are obtained from Digitalis lanata, commonly known as foxglove plant. So mechanism of action of these cardiac glycosides involves inhibition of sodium potassium ATPase. So inhibit sodium potassium ATPase. So inhibition of sodium potassium ATPase will lead to inhibition of the activity of sodium calcium exchanger. So that leads to increased accumulation of calcium in the cell. This will stimulate the stored calcium from sarcoplasmic reticulum. So this will increase ultimately intracellular calcium concentration, and this causes increased force of contraction. Increased force of contraction. So remember, digoxin and other cardiac glycosides do not have much effect on the heart rate. They mainly increase force of contraction. That is why they are known as cardiotonic drugs. Cardiotonic action. They increase force of contraction, strengthens the systole and lengthens the diastole. They strengthen systole by brisk and forced contraction. By increasing the force of contraction, they shorten, they strengthen the systole and shorten the systole, but lengthen the diastole. When the diastole is lengthened, the heart muscle can be better prepared for the next contraction. That is what is the exact mechanism by which these are going to be useful to increase the force of contraction. That is what is known as cardiotonic action in case of heart failure. When it comes to the digoxin pharmacokinetics, digoxin is a drug having high volume of distribution. The volume of distribution is around 500 liters in a 70 kg. This was given before. Digoxin is absorbed well by oral route and it has got a high volume of distribution of approximately 500 liters in a typical 70 kg adult. That is why to compensate for its high distribution, we have to give initial loading dose or digitalizing dose. So we have to give a loading or digitalizing dose initially to compensate for its distribution, to bring up the plasma levels rapidly to the desired level. To achieve effective cardiotonic action, we need to give a loading dose or digitalizing dose. And half-life is around 36 hours. Half-life of digoxin is around 36 hours. Then we have, now let us come to the cardiac effects of digitalis. As I told you before, shortens and strengthens the systole, lengthens the diastole. It is having cardiotonic action. Heart rate is more or less not much altered. And low doses is having parasympathomimetic action. This digoxin at low doses has parasympathomimetic action. Parasympathomimetic action. And high doses causes stimulation of central sympathetic outflow. So high doses cause sympathomimetic action. Low doses parasympathomimetic and high doses sympathomimetic. Sympathomimetic action. In other words, low doses of digoxin at low normal therapeutic doses of digoxin has vagomimetic action. That means decreased pacemaking activity that decreases automaticity in the pacemaker, that is SA node, and decreases conduction velocity at the AV node. These are the two important actions. For example, decreased conduction velocity in the AV node is, it serves an important purpose of the treatment of the atrial flutter and fibrillation. For example, in case of atrial flutter and fibrillation, the atria are beating at the rate of more than 300. And if all the atrial beats, these are bombarding the AV node and they want to cross the AV node and get transmitted to the ventricles, so that they tend to increase the ventricular rate also to 300 or whatever. So in such case, when you use digoxin, the AV nodal refractory period is increased. That means the impulses that are bombarding the AV node from the atria are not, all of them are not allowed to go forward to the ventricles. So this vagomimetic action of digoxin to especially decrease the conduction velocity, to decrease the conduction velocity, to increase the refractory period, to make AV node less responsive to all these atrial impulses is better utilized for the treatment of atrial flutter and fibrillation. Then other ECG findings includes prolongation of PR interval. PR interval is prolonged. So that is nothing but its action on the AV node. AV nodal, increased AV nodal refractoriness. So prolongs PR interval, but shortens the, so prolongs PR interval, shortens QT interval. Shortens the QT interval. So QT interval tells us about the ventricular action potential, total ventricular action potential. So because of the strengthening and shortening of the systole, there is shortening of the QT interval. So coming to the adverse effects of digoxin, digoxin causes wide range of adverse effects, ranging from simple coupled beats or premature contractions to life threatening ventricular arrhythmias. So it causes coupled beats or bigeminy, which can be treated with oral potassium supplements, Then if there is development of serious arrhythmias, we need parenteral potassium. For serious arrhythmias, we need parenteral potassium. And lignocaine. Lignocaine is the most important drug that is used for the treatment of serious ventricular arrhythmias caused by digoxin. Then if there is severe ventricular fibrillation, the treatment of choice for ventricular fibrillation is cardioversion, Then if there is ventricular or supraventricular tachycardia, we have to use a drug like propranolol. And if there is severe bradycardia, we have to use obviously atropine. So this digoxin is producing a wide range of cardiac adverse effects, ranging from coupled beats to serious ventricular arrhythmias, supraventricular tachycardia, sinus bradycardia. So the treatment is different for different types of cardiac adverse effects produced by digoxin. And in case of severe digitalis intoxication, severe digitalis toxicity or poisoning, that is treated with digibind, digitalis antibodies, because the dialysis and all, hemodialysis all is not going to be very helpful, because the digoxin has distributed to the nook and corner of the body because of high volume of distribution. So it is not justified to go for hemodialysis in case of digital toxicity. Rather, we have to use anti-digitalis antibodies, digibind. And we have number of MCQs asked with regard to the interaction of digitalis with the electrolytes present in the body. So like calcium, hypercalcemia potentiates digitalis toxicity. Hypokalemia and hypomagnesemia. So hypercalcemia, increased extracellular calcium, hypokalemia and hypomagnesemia, these are the factors that increase the toxicity of digoxin. That means increased calcium, decreased potassium and magnesium will aggravate the or increase the toxicity of digoxin. So these are the important interactions with ions like calcium, magnesium and potassium. Then we have discussed about the cardiac adverse effects, and we will see what are the extra cardiac adverse effects of digoxin. So outside the heart, GIT is the most sensitive system with regard to the adverse effects of digoxin. It is manifested as nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, These are the three important adverse effects: nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. Are the real important adverse effects that involves GIT. Then digoxin is also known for visual disturbances and altered color perception. So there are number of MCQs on the adverse effects of digoxin with regard to color perception and visual disturbances. It also causes gynecomastia. So altered color perception, gynecomastia, visual disturbances. So these are the important adverse effects of digoxin. Then coming to the contraindications. What are the conditions in which we should not use? Contraindications. So where we should not use digoxin? As usually, hypercalcemia, hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, etc. Then in case of myocardial infarction, hypothyroidism, severe myocarditis and WPW syndrome. These are all the important contraindications for the use of digoxin. So hypokalemia, MI, hypercalcemia, hypomagnesemia, hypothyroidism, severe myocarditis and WPW syndrome. Coming to the drug interactions. So we have seen interactions of calcium with ions. But what are the drugs that influence and that increase or decrease the actions of digoxin, which reflects ultimately on the safety and toxicity? So loop diuretics, thiazides and corticosteroids, increase the digoxin toxicity because they produce hypokalemia. Loop diuretics, thiazides and corticosteroids increase the digoxin toxicity, potentiates the digoxin toxicity because they produce hypokalemia. So any drug that produces hypokalemia worsens the digoxin toxicity. Then we have amiodarone, quinidine, verapamil, tetracyclines. I repeat, amiodarone, quinidine, verapamil, tetracyclines. All these drugs displace digoxin from the plasma protein binding sites. So protein binding site, digoxin is displaced from its plasma protein binding site. So digoxin will become more free in the plasma and produces more action and even more toxicity. These are the important interactions of digoxin with electrolytes, with ions and with the drugs. Next we have drugs that decrease the actions of digoxin, drugs that decrease the activity or toxicity of digoxin. Exactly not toxicity, action of digoxin is decreased by certain drugs like phenytoin and phenobarbital. As you all know, phenytoin and phenobarbital are known for enzyme induction. So phenytoin and phenobarbital increase the metabolism of digoxin and decrease the pharmacological action. Then antacids and sucralfate, they interfere with the absorption. So there are quite a good number of MCQs that are asked previously with regard to the interactions of digoxin with drugs and interaction of digoxin with the electrolytes, etc. So phenytoin and phenobarbital by means of enzyme induction increase the metabolism of digoxin and decrease the action, and antacids and sucralfate, they interfere with the absorption. Coming to the therapeutic uses of digoxin, digoxin therapeutic uses. So we are discussing digoxin basically because it is an important cardiotonic drug with regard to heart failure. Then digoxin is also used for the treatment of paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia. See, it is surprising to note that digoxin can cause different types of arrhythmias, and digoxin is an important antiarrhythmic drug as well. So digoxin can be used for the treatment of paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia. For PSVT, we have other drugs. like adenosine, verapamil, esmolol, etc. So along with them we have even digoxin. Then atrial flutter and fibrillation. Atrial flutter and fibrillation. I told you, in case of atrial flutter and fibrillation, atrial flutter or atrial fibrillation. In case of atrial flutter and fibrillation, the number of atrial beats at the rate of around 300 per minute when it continuously bombards the AV node, and if the AV node transmits them further to the ventricles, there will be ultimately a danger of ventricular fibrillation. So to protect the ventricles from the atrial fibrillation, we have to make we have to do something at the level of AV node, and that is done by digoxin by increasing the refractoriness, or by increasing refractory period, or by decreasing conduction velocity at the AV node, so that all the atrial impulses will not reach the ventricles. In that way, ventricles are protected. Next, we have next group of drugs that we have are diuretics. Next group of drugs we have are diuretics. So diuretics are helpful in case of congestive heart failure, mainly by decreasing sodium and water retention. So when there is decrease in the sodium and water retention, obviously the edema will be relieved. So diuretics not only relieve peripheral edema, and drugs like furosemide is life saving in case of pulmonary edema that occurs due to LVH, left ventricular failure, or left ventricular hypertrophy with subsequent failure. So the diuretics that are helpful in case of this congestive heart failure are furosemide, bumetanide, and loop diuretics like furosemide and bumetanide, and thiazide diuretics like hydrochlorothiazide, chlorothalidone, chlorothiazide, etc. But remember, furosemide is supposed to be the drug of choice. Furosemide is drug of choice for pulmonary edema that occurs due to acute LVH, acute LVF, pulmonary edema due to acute left ventricular failure. And spironolactone, eplerenone, and finerenone, we have potassium sparing diuretics like spironolactone, eplerenone, finerenone. So these are the drugs that not only prevents the hypokalemia that is supposed to be caused by loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics, which especially when they are combined with digoxin, they increase or aggravate the toxicity. So we have to combine digoxin with loop diuretics and again with potassium sparing diuretics, so that the hypokalemia that is supposed to be caused by loop diuretics or thiazide diuretics is going to worsen the digoxin toxicity. To prevent that, we have to combine another group of diuretics like spironolactone or eplerenone, which are potassium sparing diuretics. So they not only spare potassium and prevent hypokalemia, but they also, especially because they are aldosterone antagonists, as I told you before, that aldosterone is also responsible for the so-called pathological remodeling. So that is also controlled by these potassium sparing diuretics. So aldosterone antagonists spare potassium, prevent hypokalemia, and prevent digoxin toxicity, number one, and they also delay the pathological progression of the disease by blocking the bad actions of aldosterone with regard to remodeling, etc. Next group of drugs we have are ACE inhibitors. So in case of heart failure, ACE inhibitors decrease the formation of angiotensin II, because angiotensin II is also one of the important culprits in CHF along with aldosterone and norepinephrine. So decreased formation of angiotensin II will decrease vasoconstriction. So preload and afterload are decreased by preventing the formation of angiotensin II. That is done by ACE inhibitors. So ACE inhibitors decrease preload, decrease afterload, decrease the formation of aldosterone, and aldosterone formation is decreased means there is decreased sodium and water retention, and volume is also decreased, and aldosterone mediated remodeling is also decreased. So ఏసీ ఇన్హిబిటార్స్ ఆర్ హ్యావింగ్ అన్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ రోల్ విత్ రిగార్డ్ టు ద పెథోజెనసిస్ ఆర్ డిలేయింగ్ ది పెథలాజికల్ ప్రోగ్రెషన్ అండ్ పెథలాజికల్ రీమోడలింగ్ దట్ ఈస్ వాట్ ఈస్ ది ఎగ్జాక్ట్ రోల్ ఆఫ్ ఏసీఈ ఇన్హిబిటార్స్ సో ది రెడ్యూస్ ప్రీలోడ్ ది రెడ్యూస్ ఆఫ్టర్ లోడ్ ది రెడ్యూస్ సోడియం అండ్ వాటర్ రిటెన్షన్ అండ్ ది రెడ్యూస్ కార్డియక్ అండ్ వాస్క్యులర్ రీమోడలింగ్ దెన్ వీ హ్యావ్ ERBs. So more or less the same type of action or same kind of benefits are also produced by ERBs. So the type of benefit that is produced by AC inhibitors in heart failure is also more or less similar with ERBs as well.